the first event in English of our school. We're happy to be in to see you in such large numbers. You know, Bucharest is a mass of traffic, and we're happy that you're all here. The first speaker is going to be Anton and Eugen from Computational Biology of Aging Group. They're both bioinformaticians, and they're going to present to you how to use machine learning to prioritize genes. So, please, I let you.
Okay.
We are very glad to be here. Despite the coronavirus, I see that our topic is very interesting, so people can have some risks. So both me and Eugen, we are working in systems biology of aging group. And we are not AI researchers, we are bioinformaticians, so we are mostly using AI to solve different tasks in our research. And today we want to show you how machine learning is used in bioinformatics, using one of our research projects as an example. What you can see there on top, you see some icons. And there is some specific thing about the way how those icons are ordered. So do you have the guesses why we ordered the icons this way? It has something to do with aging research. Any guesses? It's not about aging research. Here it's any other guesses? So you see like whale, human, cat, fox. Any guesses why whale goes first?
It's the lifespan.
Yeah. Right you are. So as you can definitely see here that whales, they live around 200 years, and red foxes only 21, and humans are somewhere in the middle. And what is the most interesting here is that if we want to live way longer, it's not possible to live like 200 years just with a good lifestyle. So we need way, way more serious regenerative medicine and genetic interventions. And one of the way how we can actually learn what we should do is actually looking at species like whales that live 200 years, or Greenland sharks that live 500 years, how they manage to do such well, and what we can borrow from them. And if we look into like different animals, we see that actually the maximum lifespan of species, it can vary like million folds. And one of the ways, so everybody of you learned at school about DNA, so the first idea to actually investigate what is different about them is actually looking into their genomes. And here you see actually the number of nucleotides, numbers of letters in the genomes, and from like viruses with tens of thousands of letters to mammals, reptiles, and others with billions. And I'm just curious, I mean, here we have it sorted by the genome size. Do you think, do you have any ideas what species we will see on top? So we have like viruses in the bottom, here we have mouse, we have cat. Any guesses? Okay. Any other guesses?
I think it should be something very old. Something which is very old.
genomes than cat, but very, very surprisingly, we have amoeba who has like the hugest genome ever existing in animal kingdom. So it's not always intuitive. And there is a lot of about not the size, but the way how the genome is organized and used. If we look into the genomes of different species and compare them between each other, we actually see that as we all have like single ancestors in the past, that close species like mammals, they have a lot of DNA in common. And of course, the sizes of genomes, they differ a lot. But if you look, compare like monkey and human, you see that 98% is the same, and only a small number of SNPs is like point mutations, and small number of SPs, so it's like insertions or deletions, is different. So mostly we are almost the same. That is quite good because if we want to learn from similar species, we only have to look into the differences. And so here, what you see, everybody probably knows that there is like a species tree. So we had an ancestor with, say, monkeys, and so technically we can all find a hypothetical same ancestor for most life on yours. But not many people know that actually there are also trees for genes. And in our use case, it's something that is the most important. So when we have like this, it's called like a speciation event. Imagine that we had a same ancestor like between, here like human and dog very, very long ago. And when speciation occurs, it means that two different groups become different enough that we can consider them as different species. So it's kind of accumulation of changes. But if we look at in terms of like gene trees, we know that like 90-something percent genes are pretty much the same for all mammals. That means that when the species diverge, some genes, they remain the same. So the sequence will be, actually for most of the genes, the sequence will be almost the same. But some genes that actually define how we are different, they can either get speciation, so they get some mutation, so they become different. Or what actually is also very common is that we lose some genes that we don't need, or we have a duplication of genes. So many of like a simple gene like hemoglobin, we have, or like beta globin, we have three copies of these genes that actually was part of duplication events. And as an example, if we want to learn how to be like long living as well, so we should look into how their genes are different, and we should prioritize the genes. And there are actually two ways of looking into it. So ideally, we want like to find the genes that we think that are important for our desired time, our outcome, like living longer. And then we can consider doing some CRISPR and some genetic interventions to actually reach same effects on humans. Or we can consider drugs that will activate similar genes, it's called orthologs, in humans. And actually we can look into this with two ways. So just a small reminder what we have in our organisms that, well, it's just metaphor, so everybody knows about DNA, like a storage HDD or maybe SSD if you want to be faster for all our information. But there are also things that's not only about how it's stored, but it's also about how those instructions in our genes, how they are read. And for reading, this DNA should be transcribed, in other words, copied to RNA. And then these RNAs are like catalyzing reactions, like building cytoskeleton of the cells, or like transferring signals. And when we want how we can learn from long-living species, what we can look? We can look where DNA is different. So we can, if we will find good targets, maybe we can make a CRISPR to make some genetic editing on human to actually reach the same effect. Of course, having cell cultures and animal trials before. But the other way how we can look is actually the activities of the genes, because different genes, they are read in a very different way. For instance, we have hemoglobin, so it's beta and alpha globin genes, and it's mostly transcribed to RNA only in blood cells, and in other cells, it's not active, so it's not red. You almost don't have RNAs in other cells. That's why we are not all red. We are of another color. And the way how we actually focus in our project is that we wanted to look at RNAs into the activities. So some genes, maybe they have very similar sequence or the same sequence, but they may be more active in long-living animals. And if we will figure out the most important of them, what we can do, we can use stuff like activating CRISPR that instead of like editing those genes can make them more active, again, can make reading of them more often. Like, for instance, if it is DNA repair gene, it will be read more often, so there will be more DNA repair protein, and whenever damage occurs, it will be fixed hopefully better. And so what we did in our research, so here is like a bioinformatic pipeline. So we took a bunch of species. So it was 29 species and it was like 5 tissues, because even though genomes of most of the cells are pretty much the same, but transcriptomes, so RNA molecules, because different genes are read in different cells, cell types differently, they are different. So we needed like to have 5 organs. Then we looked, so what I mentioned, that there are similar genes in different species, it's called ortholog. So we compared orthologs all together. We did some processing with RNA sequencing, and after that we did the feature selection part to select the most interesting genes that we want to hopefully use some interventions at them. And then we did some other results to interpret the results. And now I am giving the word to my colleague Eugen to tell about the machine learning techniques that we used for this part.
Data that Anton talked about. So we'll go through, we'll reiterate through what kind of data we need for this, then we'll go through some basic steps of data analysis, like exploratory data analysis, feature selection, and then we'll go through some other things that hopefully will be interesting for you. So a toy data set, just to illustrate the kind of data that we use. So in this case, as in the common TiDB format, the rows represent the samples, and each sample is labeled with a source or an organ and a species. And those cryptic strings correspond to actual real species. So the columns represent features, which in our case are gene activities or gene expressions. And they are labeled with unique identifiers in this effect. Okay. The values represent a real valued number from 0 to infinity, which are indicative of the activity of that gene in that organ, in that species. So as you can see, in this particular case, we had 114 samples, and 4,264 genes. So, to do some a bit of exploratory data analysis to understand the data better. First of all, we notice that the data is high dimensional in the sense that the number of features is, roughly speaking, 40 times the number of samples, which represents a good example of the curse of dimensionality and of the curse of bioinformatics in general. Another thing that is important to realize, given the biological knowledge, is the non-independence. And now I would like to ask you a question. What do you think I mean by non-independence? Statistical point of view, but the question is, do I refer to the dependency of samples or features?
Features.
Features. Okay. Samples. Well, it's both. So, this one refers to samples, actually, you're right, because, for example, if we take the activity of genes in humans and in rats and monkeys. So, we know that humans are closer to monkeys evolutionary, so we would, from biological knowledge, a priori, may suppose that the expression profile of a human organ would be more similar to a monkey organ. But you're also right. Genes are very correlated among each other, and that sets up data set as one that is multicollinear. And multicollinear data sets are data sets in which features are highly correlated among each other, and the way to diagnose that is through variance correlation factor, in our case, which is, well, it's infinity on a computer with your overflow, but you can calculate it. It's basically you take your data set, you take a model that tries to predict gene I activity from all the other features, you take the R squared of that model, and then you can compute the weight, which will be a number from 1 to infinity. Higher number means the bigger the problem of multiple linearity. So this means that the data set and the regime look at is a high dimensional data set with low sample size. Okay, to do further exploration, we do dimensionality reduction and plotting, PCA, common, sorry for the smaller font of the title. PCA is a common procedure for looking into that. And you can see two plots, one on the left, one on the right. The one on the left labels the points by the five organs that are in our data set, and the one on the right labels each data point by species. And which of the two plots show at least some pattern?
The left.
The left one, yes. Generally, when we do that, we look for outliers, obviously, which may represent either anomalies or interesting samples. We also look for batch effects, which is a common topic in bioinformatics, but we'll not go into it now, and how samples separate based on different labels. Now, a question for you, which the answer to which may be suggested by the plots. So, generally speaking, which do you think is more similar? A cat liver to a cat kidney, or a cat liver to a human liver? Now, similarity in this case, it's not anatomical, it's not by color, it's not by size, it's by the biological processes that are active in these organs, because that's what we measure. We measure gene expression, which relates to the biological processes that are active. So what do you think? I mean, you know, cat liver should be slightly different than human liver, since cat at least don't drink as much alcohol as humans. And cat liver may be similar to cat kidney, because they're both the same species. So please take your chance to try it. So the answer, you think it's cat liver to human liver? Why?
Because the plot on the left shows a pattern.
Yeah. Well, this is the right answer. I don't necessarily think this is the argument to it, but this is the right answer. Actually, to objectively answer this question, these are not the best plots for doing it. You do a dendrogram. Label the tree with the accept the organs and the species, and you would see how to cluster. But they do, you do see in this plot that samples tend to aggregate by organ. And you also see interesting patterns, like the organ which is labeled with orange is an organ that is far more different than the other organs. It's the brain. So you do expect the brain, in terms of biological processes, to be much more different than heart, kidney, liver, lung, and so on. Okay, so we did some do some basic exploration. Then we want to find genes that are interesting. What do we mean by interesting? We mean genes that associate with lifespan of species in different organs or in multiple organs. Why we do that? We want to, one, identify these genes, two, understand them in order to gain biological knowledge, and three, with this kind of knowledge, maybe to intervene or at least get the biological insight. So, feature selection. You can see, that's a problem of optimization. So in this example, you have 10 features represented by 10 cells in this case. But the problem of the task of feature selection is to select a subset of them, which the procedure itself can be parameterized by the number of features that we keep or the performance of the model that we are left with at the end. It can be framed in different ways, but that's the essence of it, right? So given the fact that we have about 4,000 genes, and we can either select or include or not include each gene in the subset of features that we are left at the end of feature selection. We get an exponential space that, it's common to show that the number is bigger than 10 to the power of 82, which, does somebody know what does it represent? It's the number of atoms in the universe, and each atom would be a computational unit. This is kind of argument. It's a very large space to explore. Okay, so it's a discrete optimization algorithm. So the space, so why do we do feature selection? One reason to do it is to simplify the model. That's why I do it. This gives you reduced training times, reduced chance of overfitting. And at the same time, it leads to knowledge discovery by the same process that I initially introduced. Select important features from the large pack of features. How is it done? It can be done with multiple methods, and they're classified according to how they explore the space of features. First is filters, which basically go over each feature one by one, get a metric from that, and then either by thresholding, either by limiting the number of or either taking the top 100 ranked features, decides on what features should be kept in the subsort, in the selection. There are wrappers, there are ways of doing it in the model itself, like lasso, but since this presentation is more about the techniques that are used, let's keep going into more details about specific techniques. It's just that with this slide, I want to tell you that there are a lot of variants of feature selection, and it's a large direction to explore if you're interested in it. And this supports that. It's a table from the paper, which is cited at the bottom of the slide. There are various procedures for doing feature selection. Some are linear, some are non-linear. Most of them do not guarantee globally optimal solutions. Some are scalable, some are not, and so on. Okay, now Bayesian feature selection. This has to do something with this Bayes formula and Bayesian statistics, right? So the reason why you would like to do this is that sometimes you may have a priori knowledge about how genes are correlated among each other. And one source of this kind of information is gene networks. So due to large body of biological knowledge and research, we know a lot of gene-gene interactions, which are represented as networks. So given this, we can use the structure of these networks in our models to improve our feature selection process. How this can be done? In this graph that is shown on the slide, which is a huge mistake from my side to make notes so small, but the point is that if we you take a node from the bottom, from a bottom leaf, we can take only its parents and its children and ignore the rest of the nodes in the graph, because all the information is all the information passes through those nodes and the others can be ignored. So that's a pretty high-level way of saying it, but the reason is the point is that you can use it, and you can do this kind of networks and do machine learning on them, and you can get feature selection by implementing in the procedure itself a priori information in terms of networks. And this is one example of application in our project where you get genes and that are associated with lifespan. By the way, if you have any questions or you think I made a mistake or something like that, please ask. Not any time. So, any questions up until now, please?
Did you consider using the graph databases for analysis?
Yes. Currently, we use the graph database to store SparkGraph.
The thing is that for analysis for ortology information, it's like a graph with how genes relate to each other. So we use GraphDB and the language to query it like SparkQL. So it's for storage. There are also things like taking into account like interaction networks of genes between each other, like called interactomics. This particular project, we didn't use it, but overall in ZDF, we have a person who is doing representation learning based on interaction graphs between genes. So there we have embeddings for each of the genes that can allow us to take into account their connections. We couldn't use this in this project because here we have too many species, and we don't have all the embeddings trained for all the species.
Any other questions? Not too much. Suggestions? Okay. So besides supervised techniques, we also apply unsupervised techniques to understand many patterns or processes in our data. Matrix factorization is one of them. So it's an example of feature transformation because we map from one feature space to another feature space. You can also do clustering for dimensionality reduction, right? And for as a form of unsupervised learning and feature transformation. But in contrast to matrix factorization, clustering requires more hyperparameters. It requires specifying a distance, at least it requires specifying a distance or similarity metric, and the linkage method. While matrix factorization, although a linear technique, it doesn't require such specifications except for choosing a rank. So, without going into too much details of how this works,
there's a norm or something that you optimize when you optimize the matrix factorization. You can have Frobenius norm or Kullback ladder, and a different factorization might be similar to the distance in the factorization.
Yeah, sure. So, thank you. Yeah, the comment is thank you. The comment is about the fact that when you do matrix factorization, you optimize a distance metric between matrices, and you can implicitly introduce the distance by designing the error function. Is that thing? The idea is to factorize data matrix into two other matrices, in this case labeled as U and V. And the hyperparameter here besides the error function is the D, which is the rank of the matrix, and the higher the D, the more degrees of freedom there are in the model, and the closer the factorization can capture the initial data matrix. In our case, samples, users are samples, movies are genes. And the point of interest of us are that we also label what could be called super genes or super samples, which are not a dozen linear combinations of the initial genes. And these are interesting because they represent the patterns that are most prominent in the data set. So we next look at the matrix U and we take the columns, which represent the super genes, which are a linear combination of genes in the initial data space, and we analyze them for various things like we'll see next. So we take the matrix U. And we get a heat map, which is also a cluster map, at least on one side. The lighter lighter color represents higher density. Rows are samples, columns are super genes. And on the left sidebar, you have the organs labeled by five colors. So what you can see, at least visually from this, is that there are some super genes or factors that encode that are very specific to an organ. So they probably represent processes that are specific to that organ. For example, the super gene labeled 1 seems to be very active in the red organ. The super gene labeled 3, so you probably don't see because there are two different colors, but yeah.
So I think it's in maybe organ.
Yeah, so you see the super genes labeled from 1 to 5 are specific to one organ, not other. In our case, we analyzed each of the super genes. We found one that was highly associated with lifespan, which was interesting for us because then we can take the super gene and look at the weights that the super gene attributes to each of the genes from the initial data space. For that, we can get an understanding of which genes are more or less important, and we can also, using the other specific bioinformatics techniques, we can get insight into the biological processes that the super genes represent. So, to the next topic.
Was it on the graph?
No. There are separate techniques. There are separate techniques. This is to showcase the use of unsupervised learning in our project. Okay. So, getting insight into the biology, this slide is about following a common procedure that has to be done in bioinformatics. So, at the end of any of this analysis, you get a list of genes, which presumably are important. And this list can be large, it can be hundreds of genes. And you need to understand this list of genes. What does it represent? Your biological processes. Okay? So, how to make sense of a set of genes of interest that could have been outputted by any of the analysis that I have presented to you. So one way is to take each gene, to enumerate the gene, and for each gene to do a manual search, to call an expert, and try to make sense of it. But there probably could be ways to automatize this by formalizing at least some aspects of the biological knowledge. So to do this, people in bioinformatics have predefined gene sets. So for example, a gene set which would represent glucose metabolism. It would be just a set of genes that have been shown by prior research to be involved in glucose metabolism. Given, and there are thousands of these kinds of sets for different processes, for cellular localization, for different terms of interest. Given the set of genes that we've got, and the predefined gene set, you can compute an enrichment. You can define a statistical procedure to get an answer to the question whether the genes that we got are represented in this set more than on average. So just as a toy example, in this case, the gene set of glucose metabolism is of size 4. The overlap with our gene set, at least from what we see, is of 3 genes. And I don't show the procedure, but you can have a statistical procedure based on hypergeometric tests, for example, to compute the p-value and the false discovery rate. So in our case, we also get processes. This is what it would look like and what it looks like. It's basically a list of processes with identifies and with selections.
This one is for the genes that you mentioned that you found correlated in
So for those people that have some biological background, like fatty acid metabolic process, this is a biological process that has been shown to be involved in aging and longevity. So roughly speaking, without getting into much details.
What's the size?
What's the size of what?
What's the size there?
Yeah, the size represents the size of the gene set. So for example, fatty acid metabolic process would be a gene set that would have 90 genes. Okay? So, and we, for example, make an analysis and we find 500 genes. And from those 500 genes that we found, maybe 30 of them are in the intersection of these two sets. And then we can have a statistical procedure to evaluate for whether, for the hypothesis, whether genes in our list are overrepresented in the 35 gene set. Does this answer your question?
E values are corrected?
E values are not corrected because then you have an FDR. I mean,
I understand. They're pretty low, though. They're not very, they're not very impressive. They're not very small.
Yeah. I agree. This is just an example to showcase this. Yeah, I agree. This is, generally speaking, this is the comment is that this is not impressive because this is not a very low p-value. When you do a real analysis, if you do it right and you have the right data, you can have much lower p-values up to e to the minus 10 and so on. So now we have a lot of gene sets, and we like a structured way of dealing with them because then it's just a list of set of gene sets. And one of the greatest efforts in bioinformatics was to design and is continued in designing what is called the gene ontology. So gene ontology is a computational model of biological systems, which is dynamic in the sense that it's continuously improving by adding new biological results, which are drawn from research, from laboratory research. So in the gene ontology graph, which represents the biological knowledges, is made of processes, it's not genes. It's usually biological processes. And the processes themselves are structured in a hierarchy of processes, which ultimately should represent the biological knowledge, the complete biological knowledge, once we get to that point. Any questions on this? With that, I'd like to thank you and invite Anton.
Okay. So we just gave part actually of what has been done as a project. So we also had just to name it, we had used some ensemble based on several feature selection methods with bootstrapping and aggregation. Then we also did some analysis with phylogenetic contrast. It's a specific technique on taking into account the connections between species, and so technically we used way more methods than Eugen mentioned here. I just decided to not to overload with too much details. And in this project, who was participating? So it's me, Eugen, and on probabilistic models we had Rodrigo. Vlada helped a bit with soft voting. So when you have an ensemble of multiple algorithms like light GPM, SVR, and so on, you have results from many of them, you have to evaluate how you will take into account their predictions. And she also worked on explainability, so it's things like Shapley additive values to actually predict and also select genes and predict how exactly they are influencing the lifespan. And we also had people helping us on biology, so Dmitry Tor and Enviel, and of course we have our group leader, Robita Kulaga. development part in the project, so soon we will have a paper on our analysis, and also there will be a database of gene expressions between species. And apart from this project, we are also doing multiple other projects. And I just want to mention one of them, because this summer we will be doing Google Summer of Pod Wizards. So this is this project is, well, we call it Generative Pylon Project. So one of the problems that Eugen already mentioned with bioinformatical data is that they are imbalanced and highly dimensional. So for highly dimensional, you saw that you can have like 40,000 genes in one sample, while have way smaller number of samples. So here you see like an example of, so it's human datasets, it's GTX dataset, that's relatively square, so around 20,000 samples to like 20,000 coding genes. So not all genes, but the most relevant ones. And when you look into the way how you see all this great, so it's widely plot, so it shows actually a distribution of samples by, so it's ages when the people died, because you cannot get enough samples, say, from liver or kidney. If it is a healthy person, he would not be happy to have something sticked into his liver. So usually people do it when people are dead or having an operation. And another is, here you see that, so in GTX they mostly use the people who died and sacrificed for science, and you see the time after the death, because you have also problems that gene activity change, genes are still active after you die for some time. And you see that it looks crazy. So it's like we have, I mean, it doesn't look like normal distribution, it has those waves. The reason for this is that because of privacy concerns on humans, they are rounding down the data, and because they are afraid of the anonymization. And it's a huge problem. It's the main pain, one of the main pain aspects in biomedical machine learning, that to get real data, you have to go through bureaucratic hell. So I know some companies that like spend, so they have a special person who is hired only to do paperwork in negotiations with providers of biomedical data to get all papers signed to access the data. So they have full-time people just on this paperwork. And that means that, I mean, in the world there are like way more machine learning engineers than people who manage to get through this hell of accessing the data. And now actually Vlada is now actively working on it right now. We are trying to play a bit with generative approaches, so like variational autoencoders and generative adversarial networks, to actually first generate those classes that we are lacking. That, for instance, like here, you see that most of the people die when they are old, and usually they, if they are young, they usually die because of accidents, not because of heart attacks. And you have a problem that you miss sometimes of samples. And another problem is like anonymity. If we can like have ways to generate synthetic data sets, that means that we can reach multiple data providers with those super secret, super paperwork, easy data sets, and train synthetic models that will be synthetic data, not as good as real one, but machine learning community all over the world will be able to train on it without a big headache, and also send their models to be validated to these data providers. And we right now we have, with Open Bioinformatics Foundation, we have a project, and I think students still can apply before end of March to have their summer working on it. Yeah, and that's what I wanted to tell you about, and thank you very much, and we'll be happy to answer your questions. Yeah.
So, for the previous slide, yeah. So the
I mean, it's kind of stupid, in my opinion, because people consented to be donated by science, and kind of they, most of them, well, some are still alive, because, I mean, if to take samples from blood, you don't need to kill a person for this. But, I mean, some people, they die. So, I mean, ideally, I mean, why should you care how people will use your data if you are already dead? But for some reason, they still want to keep those donors anonymized, and they mess up the data set not to be able to learn that those dead people, that you can identify them.
So, could it be an issue that the type of people who consent, the distribution of people who consented for this data set might be different from the distribution of general population?
I think it's the smallest issue, honestly, because we have several types of issues that are way more important. Like, we have problems with how to die, how much time goes after the death, so it's more of a source of a noise than which people you have, which people consented.
And the way to answer it is probably something like black market research.
Well, I mean, the thing is that, I mean, personally for me, I think that science and curing aging and diseases is more important than privacy, but most of the world doesn't agree with me, and that's why in some cases people don't mess up the data much and you can still use a little bit anonymized data, but in most of the cases you either do bureaucracy hell and to get real data, or you train on models with rounded values and you get bad predictions because of that. Yeah?
Have you considered, or how do you regard the other approach with genetic algorithms to study?
Yeah, we at some point applied it. The best results in terms of model fit, R-squared, were given actually by the Bayesian learning method, not by genetic algorithms, although we implemented genetic algorithms as well. Yeah.
I also want to say that, I mean, in terms of also, so we applied a lot of different algorithms, so for cross-species data, we were limited by several hundreds of samples, actually more than you saw on slides, because we added more samples recently. But for like larger data sets like GTX data sets, we also, I mean, as we have like 20,000 samples, we also tried stuff like regressions with fully connected networks and stuff like this. And there are surprisingly gradient boosting like methods like LightGBM were the best in terms of performance. Yep.
Can you give us an example of something you deduced from all the data that would be interesting? I mean, I'm not a statistician, I'm just like from completely outside, so for me this was all statistics and stuff. But something like, I don't know, you
okay.
Found a gene that makes you live longer or something.
Okay, so well, let me, we have this issue that we are not from our computer, because, I mean, I should have links, I sent you like links from our results part, because we just didn't want to, okay, I think that it is like, probably this. Yeah, so it's part from my presentation that I did in China. But, yeah, don't be afraid, it was not recent. So we had some pathways, MPK signaling pathway, longevity regulating pathway, and glucenion conjugation pathway. We had some raw categories, so technically biological processes for RNA modification mitochondrial activities. He here is actually the chart. So when we did ensemble technique, so we had different methods. So here is an example, like you have like elastic net ensemble, you have SVR version with bootstrap aggregation, and for here it's peak, it's phylogenetic contrast normalization, so it's pretty much same methods but different normalizations. And you see that like 53 genes, they were like, 42 genes, they were like the same for whatever method we, for
can
most of the methods.
Them? Can you show them?
We have some cursor. I think that 50, so this is, for in this plot, you see technically methods are here, and intersections are here, and 19 genes are selected by all methods. And I think we had most of all categories. Let me see. So these are like biological categories for gene IDs. So we had gene sets. So many of them have something to do with DNA repair, with ubiquitation, with tumor suppression. And there are some mitochondrial genes and immune response genes. And we also looked like the diseases that were associated with those genes. We also did, Eugen only briefly mentioned like gene modules analysis, when you look how modules or many genes clustered together react and work. And so gene modules, so this part is from probabilistic models. So these are like predictions, and also how those genes, so genes can interact with each other. So we found those motifs when there are like several genes that, so we know not only the names of the genes, but we know that they act together in a way that some may activate or inhibit others.
And this was on expression data.
Yep.
This was on expression
data. Yeah, this was on gene expression data, so we decided to limit ourselves to gene expressions because it can get extremely complicated if you have both sequence and like sequences and expression. Maybe in our next paper we will try to incorporate both of them. Yeah, we just didn't want to overload you with biology. That we didn't also control well for, in some species, for instance, there were like a project to sequence a new species, and you don't have a choice like for what age of this whale or whatever species you take. You just take what they provide you. So there are species like humans and model animals, like mice, rats, whatever, for which you have a choice, so you can just compare like human with an rat of a similar age, of course, normalized to their lifespan. But enough for for non-common animals, we took what was given to us, or given what we managed to find.
So you use the average lifespan of the species?
With maximum lifespan, not
maximum.
Average. The most important, I think, it's the maximum one, because That's the way. The most important is to break our species' maximum lifespan barrier. Cancer one is GTX, so it is 20,000 around. I don't remember well by heart, but around 20,000 samples and around 20,000 genes. Or if you go lower, you can go with transcripts. It's around 120,000 transcripts. So it's for genes at least it becomes a bit squared, but still it's extremely highly dimensional. I think that for cancer, Eugen, do you remember the for cancer datasets? What, how many samples did they have?
9,000.
So even less. So it's for gene expression. It's probably in terms of biomedical data. I think that usually you have like this situation: more features than samples. Exceptions are probably blood tests. So there are like NHM's database and database on UK Biobank, but on medical blood tests you cannot get much. It's a very small number of proteins. Any other questions? Okay, so thank you very much, and if you have questions, feel free to talk with us.
One more question.
Yep.
Can you give us, us being, not being bioinformaticians, can you just give us a hint on what are the sources for the journals, or where do you intend to publish, or where should we look for information?
I think we cited some of our papers actually here. There are like different, so for the journals, there are like multiple journals. I think the last one that I applied was Aging Cell. So there are aging specific journal, and there are like more like general biological journals. If you are interested in knowing more about aging, I would rather recommend some papers. If you are more interested not in aging but say in bioinformatics, there are many online courses, and also there is Romanian Bioinformatics Society. So our lab is one of the founders, and RSBI, and they make a lot of seminars and workshops on all types of sequencing and algorithms. And you can also, of course, visit the website of our lab. It's like Aging Research Group. Very simple.
Images, of course, sequences of images, movie QA, you have a movie and you want to
questions. Multimodal QA, like we have images and text, and for example, you have recipes and you'd like to answer questions about recipes or recipes. You have like a video on how to cook something and text, and you'd like to find the perfect answers. I have also talked with Eugen and Anton in the beginning. They are using SparkQL. Of course, you also have like knowledge-based question answering, like answering questions using SparkQL. And here we have like QA over link data, QALD. And in the last couple of years, researchers started to come with some other names for question answering. Like some of them said it's like reading comprehension. You want to make a machine who reads, comprehends text, reads and comprehends text like a human. And many people in the community say it's like a buzzword. You cannot really do this. Like you can simulate, like it's still question answering. Other people say it's reasoning challenge, like the people from LNAI. It's more like media attention and more than really research. Other people say it's just sentence selection. Like I'm giving you an article from Wikipedia or part of it. I have a question, and I just want you to pick the sentence or group of sentences where you have the correct answer. And you provide this sentence or group of sentences per person, and this is perfect. And this is cool. Like sentence selection makes sense. And actually, most papers which are like reading comprehension, they are actually sentence selection tasks. And of course, if you want some, this is like factoid versus non-factoid. Yeah, so which was the first man on the moon? It's a simpler question to answer. You can just retrieve it from a knowledge graph or from a knowledge base, and it's Neil Armstrong. And if you want like non-factoid, you want an opinion, there could be several answers, like what was the role of Portugal in the Second World War, and you have a paragraph, and you could have several paragraphs. Still, if you want to see like differences, these are factoid data set, where you have like simpler answers, which are persons, and locations, dates, and so on. And for non-factoid, you have something like, you have several answers, and some of them are excellent, some of them are good, some of them are very bad. As you see, most of them, or all of them, are paragraphs. Like they are kind of an opinion. Of course, you select this opinion from a human written source. So you select it from Wikipedia, for example, or from other encyclopedias or books. But it's more like sentence selection. You need to know which are the best parts to extract. And there could be several. Like there could be several from different types of documents, or several different places in one document. So non-factoid is much more complex than factoid. Cool. One of the most used data sets for question answering is called SQUAD, stands for question answering data set. It was created about 3 years ago, and this data set, this set is for reading comprehension. We want machines, algorithms, which comprehend text in a similar way to humans. And it was a really good buzzword, because at some point with the robot, like there are machines we're going to see which act better than an average human. So we have solved question answering. Of course not. We haven't solved question answering. Like this is one of the very simple data sets that we have built. We have for question answering. So it's a closed reading comprehension data set. Many of the questions are factoid. Other ones are like simple non-factoid. All of them are like sentence or span selection. Determine which is a start token and the end token. It's like a selection of tokens in the original article. All the questions are about articles on Wikipedia, and we don't have lots of them. There are only about 400 articles from Wikipedia, and some people started to ask questions which had an answer in these articles. Some of them are pretty simple, like you see over here. You only have like two words, and some of them are a larger number of words, but most of them are like factoid. Like here you have an app, you have it's a named entity, and so on. So you don't have like very complex answers. There are very few non-factoid questions. So these questions were cross-sourced from people who put a question, and they highlighted the span where the answer was in the original article. There are lots of questions, but all of these questions are on this limited number of articles. So you kind of understand this type of articles and the type of simple question that are in the data set. And actually, the first data set was so simple that in about 1 year or 1 year and a half, performance was huge, 90%. And there were some huge biases. Like if you only added one word, a different word in a question, or added a no, the models answer the same. Like if you said, is it true that something, or is it not true that something, all these models were kind of knowing where to look at, which was a span, even if you negative the question. And in the second version, they said something like, we had more complex question, and we also have negative examples. Some questions where the model shouldn't answer. It should say, well, I cannot find the answer in the text. And they said, OK, now we really have a very good machine comprehension data set. It isn't so good as the new one. So the new one, the most distinction, the most important distinction, more complex questions, and they also have negative examples, like questions for which the methods, the algorithm shouldn't provide any answer. Related to performance, so from this data set point of view, question answering is a soft task. Like human performance, as you can see, F1 score, like weighted average between precision and recall, it's close to 90%. And the best model right now is 92.5%. So we have algorithms, so we have machine learning models, which are better than humans in answering questions, if you only look at this data set. And if you look at all these methods, they are all based on Albert and like on transformer, and we're going to see that this will be similar for other data sets as well. If you look, like 2 years ago, when this data set was what version 2 was proposed, the performance was about 60%. So from the beginning, these were like also deep learning methods, but with recurrent neural networks. So they started from 60 something and they went to 90 something. It's a pretty big increase. So the NLP community did very good in 2 years. But I want to prove you that we are still very far away from answering questions, for building computers that answer questions. A more complex data set, so the researchers weren't very pleased in Squad as a question answering data set. Hot for QA is a more complex data set, which is like more realistic to what kind of questions we would like to find answers. So these are natural questions. Natural questions means they are not imposed, like this is an article, you as a person ask a question about this article. These are questions that were asked on Google, on a real web search engine. So people were really interested in finding an answer without reading any articles. So these are natural questions. All of them are factory questions, require multi-hops. Multi-hops means you cannot find the answer only in a span, like it was for a squad. You should read several spans like this, and you need to combine the information in all of them in order to provide the correct answer. Like this is called a multi-hop. You know, you need to go to one place, gather some information, and then go again to another hop, find some other information, combine it, and only then you can provide the correct answer. Of course, not all of them are multi-hop. They also have like some easy. So the data set is split into easy, medium, and hard. So they have some single hop, but they are about 10%. They have multi-hop medium, and they have hard multi-hop questions. Article still from Wikipedia, like the question, the answer should be somewhere combining different spans from Wikipedia. And they have two versions. One is open, like you have the entire Wikipedia, answer my question. Clearly more complex. And the other one is closed, like they said, you have all the paragraphs which are correct, where you find the answer, and we also add eight distractors. Like we add eight sentences, if you want, like this, which are meaningless to finding the answer to our question. And they have two different tasks. The first one is like finding the correct answer. So we are only interested in looking at the correct answer. Like this is the answer, malfunction. It's the name of a bad. And the other, which is more interesting, because from my point of view, this is like, it's to reason, to understand why this is the correct answer. Yeah. And they need to provide supporting facts. Supporting facts are like sentences, spans from from Wikipedia, which provides a proof, like the rationale, for this suggested answer. Of course, so two different tasks, one of them simpler, the other one more complex, but this other one would be the one that you would like to provide to a human using your system. You would like to provide an explanation, so
according to explainable AI, explainable NLP, and where we want to go in the future, not just this is the answer, I don't know why. Cool. And now if we look at the results, so the results for this data set, so this is from, on the left you have the leaderboard where you have the closed, when you have the destructors, the hate destructors, and the correct ops. And on the right you have the entire Wikipedia. And you can see the results are pretty good on the left where you only have the destructors, like F1 for the answer, it's a little over 80. F1 for the support, it's about 90. But if you combine them, so there are errors in both of them. If you combine them to have correct answer and correct support, you only have about 70. So this is when you only have 8 destructors. So somebody has filtered most of Wikipedia for you. If you don't have this filtering for you, and you look on the table on the right, so this is like the correct setting, open question answering on the entire Wikipedia. We have about 70% for the correct answer, about 77% for the correct support, and we combine both of them, we only have 60% correct answer and support. Yeah, so it's a little bit better than being half wrong, but it's not very good. So it's not 90-something percent as we had for SWAT. So this is a more realistic question answering data set. And now we move to the data set that we work on. It's a data set proposed by AI2, the Allen AI Institute for AI, the Allen Institute for AI. And they said, still 2 years ago, they said, you think you solve question answering on SQUAD? We provide you ARC, the AI2 reasoning challenge, a data set where you really need to understand text in order to provide the correct answers. So it was a data set built in order to be able to understand or your models to be able to make some specific reasoning that people do when they answer questions. And we're gonna see what we mean. It doesn't mean that the models that have good scores, good accuracy, that mean at this moment, they really are able to do this reasoning, but they provide the correct answer, at least for these data sets. So which is the data they have? So we have grade school. Grade school, they have like from 5th to 8th grade. Science questions. These science questions are written by humans, so they are natural questions written by human persons. We don't know which are the supporting documents. We only know that we have like a correct answer, and we have 4 candidates. Usually we have 4 candidates, so it's a multiple choice question answering. We have 4 candidates answers, and we would like to provide the correct one. And so it's open QA. We don't know where to look for the correct answer. It should be in some science-related text, maybe science books from US, maybe on Wikipedia, but not on Wikipedia talking about, I don't know, artists and music. It should be on Wikipedia talking about biology, physics, and so on, so about science. And it's a mix of factoid and non-factoid. So some of them are resemble factoid questions, like which property of a mineral can be determined just by looking at it. But this fact is not like a simple named entity, like a person or a location. It's a property of an object, but you should understand that cluster is the correct answer. And, so it is. I'm not sorry, Luchu. Started from some data sets which are simpler, and they said we found which was our mistake in the first data sets, and now in the, are providing this reasoning data set which contains more complex questions, so 2,500 more complex questions which are answered incorrectly by simple baselines using information retrievers, so similar to what Google did until a couple of years ago using like Lucene and information retrieval engines. Or like other word occurrence algorithms like point-wise mutual information. So this was how they selected the challenge questions. And all the other ones, they are considered easy questions. And these are examples of challenge questions. And if you want, like they said, this data set requires some kind of human reasoning, So the human reasoning is like you should understand some question logic, some linguistic matching. Also, there are some multi-hop questions in the previous data sets. Being able to compare different sizes of objects, making some algebraic interpretations and equations and summations and so on. To have some hypothetical or counterfactual reasoning, meta reasoning or explanations, spatial reasoning, and understanding analogies. So this is why they call it reasoning challenge. And these are the best solutions existing 2 years ago. So for the challenge dataset, we have four candidate answers. And as you can see, all of the existing models 2 years ago, they were very close to random. Like random picking randomly one question, 25%. No. So random is here 25%, more or less. All the other proposed, like information retrieval, it was very bad. Information retrieval on Wikipedia, it was very, very bad. Point of admission information, very bad. Why? Because this is how they selected the data set. So they selected the questions which weren't answered correctly by these very simple methods. And they also provided a data set with, this is like our corpus, it's a science statements and data set. And they show that this data set is useful, like if you just index this data set, you have a better IR engine. And these are several methods, and actually these methods, some of them are like co-occurrence methods, information retrieval, PMI. Some other are like using symbolic processing or mix of deep learning and statistical symbolic rules. But others are what the best deep learning models at the moment, like BDAF and decomposable attention. There were the best recurrent neural networks existing at the moment. And you can see that BDAF here was less than 27%, so only a bit over the baseline. So the baseline. So no models were good enough in order to have even slightly good results on the challenge. And actually, you can also see another thing, that many of the models that had very good performance on the easy dataset had very bad performance on the challenge dataset. And the other way around, the models that had like a slightly better performance on the challenge dataset, they had bad results on the easy dataset. So there wasn't any model which was able to answer correctly an easy and a challenge data set. And we started working with what's called two-stage inference model. And we had a premise. The premise was like complex questions require some other reasoning than just counting words. So we should understand like the context of the question and make some kind of inference between the question answer and this context. And we call this like a two-stage model, which combine an information retrieval in order to get some candidate documents or context. And then we have several deep learning architectures, we call them solvers, which were looking at the context, the question, and each candidate answer, and seeing if like there is some kind of match. And we're going to see what like semantic match, more semantic similarity. And we're going to see so in the first stage, it was like an information retrieval engine, like we indexed Wikipedia and science books and all this stuff on a paragraph level. And we wanted to extract the most relevant context for each question and candidate answer pairs. And then in the second stage, we look at question, candidate answer, and context in order to see if we have some semantic information in them. In order to justify for the answer to be the correct answer. So what we did, like we provided a question and a candidate answer. We queried an IR engine. We just used Lucene and we indexed some science, like English Wikipedia and science books. What we introduced like a term weighting for Lucene. Like we said, only some of the words in the question are relevant. And here we have like what happens at the boiling point as the substance. And we actually put some weights on the terms and indexing Lucene. We said, and this was done by training a neural network, a simple neural network, using like semantic and syntactic features. Syntactic meaning like which is a dependency, which is a part of speech tag, and so on. And like this is our example. So boiling is the most important word in this question. Important means if we delete it, we cannot understand the question. So this is how we define importance of a term. Like if you I'm deleting this term, and I'm giving you the question, can you answer it?
And if I'm deleting boiling here, probably
nobody can answer. Boiling is the most important one. And of course, we have a data set annotated with like which are the important words. This is annotated by humans with errors and subjectivity and so on. But as you can see, a model can learn. Like, boiling is the most important point, and substance are the next ones. And happens, it's a little bit less. All the other ones are completely not important. So their weight is close to zero when indexing the our document index. Cool. So this is stage one. And in stage two, we build we have several deep learning architectures in order to look at the triplet now. So we have a question, candidate answer, and context. The context was the best context we choose from our index. We wanted, we got these solvers and we pre-trained them on different LLP tasks, which are completely different from our task. So these are kind of like, we can see them like weak classifiers. They are not trained on this task, they are trained on different tasks, but they are able to provide us information for this task. And in the end, we had an ensemble model voting the final answer. So the solvers, we had two solvers at the beginning, the start. The first one, we encoded the semantic similarity. We said it's good at computing semantic similarity. And we computed actually the semantic similarity field between the questions, the context, and the answer. This was a model that we used, like at the beginning, the question and the extracted context, they were failing to beat us. Like this was the best RNN for question answering at that moment. The answer also, we had embedding for the answer, char embedding, word embeddings, and we used a bio-LSTM in order to compute the semantic score for all these triplets. Cool. And what we did, we pre-trained it on a squad, on the previous dataset that we talked about. But of course, squad wasn't designed for a multiple choice question answering because you only had to select a sentence if you want, a span. And what we did, we transformed it into multi-choice question answering by putting in some candidates. We put wrong answers from the same article, close, nearby, and so on, in order for this model to be difficult, to learn something, to be difficult to discriminate. So the data set is completely different. Squad is from Wikipedia, no science, no nothing, completely different task, and so on. So this was one weak classifier, and the second one was framing our task as a natural language inference task. Like we said, okay, you have a question and a candidate answer. We transform it into an affirmative sentence using some basic rules and all-style NLP. And we also look at the context, and we want to see if there is an inference between, if looking at the affirmative sentence from the question and answer, we can justify the context. Yeah. Like, it's natural language inference. And there is there are several large data sets for natural language inference. It's not so good, some of them, not so bad, others. And we trained on these data sets using a similar model to this one, using again BIHA. Cool. Let's see what happened. So with this model, it was a pretty good model, it was the only model in the leaderboard who had good performance both on easy and challenged questions. It was a second for easy when we published it, and it was eighth for challenge. But at that moment, there were some methods that used BERT, like transformers. And of course, BERT is better, way better for those of you that know NLP a bit. Transformers are way better at encoding the meaning of text, this is what we know, than recurrent neural networks. But our model didn't use any BERT, didn't use any symbolic, because some of these methods used some symbolic, some rules, and made by experts. Our model was kind of end-to-end. What we got? We got 61% for easy questions and roughly 27% for hard questions, which was better than all the existing papers. Cool. And then we said, let's go to a better model. Our intuition was good. Using weak solve our task is a good idea. But I said, let's improve this idea. And we introduce like a self-attention, like the self-attention is a method used by transformers in order to compute the meaning of text. We said, let's introduce a self-attention-based neural network, we call it the attentive ranker, that learns how to rank more documents, and this is a step we call answering questions by learning to rank. So we don't only use one context, now we try to use, we use several contexts, several documents, and our model learns to rank these documents at the same time as computing the correct answer. So our main objective is to compute the correct answer, but in the meanwhile, we learn how to rank these documents. And computing the correct answer is like learning to rank by answering questions. And we've done several things. The other one, like we added several different contexts for each candidate answer, so we don't use only one, we will use several of them, because the information retrieval method is not good enough, you know, like for the first context, for the first document to be the perfect one. But in the first 10 or 20, it should be also the good one. And this is also good for multi-hop question answering. Because in multi-hop question answering, the answer is in several paragraphs. And if you are able to extract information from several paragraphs and re-ranking them, then your model will be able to answer multi-hop questions. And the third item, use transformers, use BERT. Like this was the best way of encoding meaning from text in order to combine question answer and candidate context. Cool, so this method looks like this. So in the first step, we have this information retrieval engine. We get candidate documents. And for each candidate document, we use these weak classifiers or weak discriminators similar to the ones that we have shown. One of them is a simple TF-IDF, and two others we call them document relevant discriminator, similar to the prior one, trained on SWAP. And the other one is called answer verifier discriminator. It's trained on another data set called race. This is with science questions. We can add several other discriminators if we find good discriminators. So it's like the power of several weak discriminators. Like if it's statistics, like you don't have need to have a perfect model. But if you have several different weak discriminants, and each of them learns like to answer some type of questions, like it's like having 1,000 people and each of them is expert in a specific stuff, but none of them is expert in everything. And this is like how humans work. No? We don't have a general expert in everything. We go to this one person which is an expert in everything. And this is not only in NLP, it's also like in using weak discriminators. These weak discriminators, so what we do, like we learn to rank the supporting documents by using a self-attention, like keep value attention to the self-attention. So for each of these documents, we have a vector and we compute like self-attention between all these documents. And in the end, our model computes up a score, and this score is like a rank. And this ranking is a better ranking than the one provided by pooling from information retrieval engines, like UC. And it's better than other methods and noise, like talk to facts and other documenting methods. Cool, and in the next step, like learning to rank by answering questions, we train to predict the correct answer. So we have the output, the ranking of the document from the attentive ranker. We combine using a fully connected there with the MLP. We get like the probability for each candidate answer A, B, C, D to be the correct one given the question and given the documents extracted from our information retrieval, by our information retrieval engine, and the parameters, the current parameters of the attentive rankers. Like these are theta, the current parameters of the model. And actually what happens is something like this. So the learning to rank means we have the previous model who learn how to rank documents at the beginning. The ranking is random, maybe. Because at the beginning, like it's a neural network, you don't know how to rank. Ranking is random, then you backpropagate, you rank a little bit better, you have better answers, you backpropagate, and so on and so forth. And like this is why it's like a two-step procedure. And what we do, like, we learn better how to rank documents, and learning better how to rank documents, we get better answers to our questions. And like, we can continue doing this in a bootstrapping fashion. Cool. If there are one more details, we can talk. Details and related to the results, our model surpassed the. So it was the first place for both easy and challenge dataset at the moment when it was proposed. Like, the best was like a BERT trained on several datasets, and we showed that you don't need to be trained BERT on several datasets. It's not like you have this way of using an attentive ranker. Afterward, of course, it was surpassed by BERT trained on even larger datasets and by using more powerful transformers like Albert. We have also shown like these are our results. So on the challenge dataset, we have like close to 45% accuracy, way greater improvement to the previous method, and even better than BERT. Like, this is BERT trained by Microsoft. Microsoft was on the first place. I'm sorry for Microsoft. We managed to be on the first place for a couple of weeks. We didn't manage to train BERT as good. I know probably Microsoft had a better training procedure. Our BERT was only about 42% or something like that. So even if here, like, the difference seems small, if our version of BERT, the ones that we are using, was only 42%, so our attentive ranker was way better. And on the challenge, on the East data set, it's pretty good. Like, we answered 3 out of 4 questions correctly. And what we have also shown, like, using this ranking provided by the attentive ranker without using the final layer, we have shown, using just a BERT, besides a correct answer, we have shown that it's better than using plain TF5 by using other docking bearings like DocuVec existing at that moment. And this is true if we use only the first document, even by our back ranker, but it also goes if we use like the first 10 documents or several documents. Actually, we have some other insights. Only the first document or using few documents in order to compute the correct answer is not very good. We need to have several documents. Like, this is what happens when you have a larger number of candidates. So for the easy task, you need about 20 contexts, 20 documents in order to provide the, a better answer. And here you see we reach a plateau. So about 20 is enough. And for the challenge data set, we need about 50. From here, we reach a plateau. It doesn't make sense. Like, if we add more than 50, we cannot learn anything better. We can get even worse. And actually, our weak classifiers, like if we look at the power of the weak classifiers, only TF5DF is not very good. If we add the document document relevant discriminator, we go to 74%. And if we also, it's a second weak discriminator, the weak classifier ABD, we get the final score. So each of these weak classifiers improves, has a small improvement. Well, and then I can ask, what can we do even further? We can add several more powerful transformer-based discriminators. So BERT was the first one, but then Isanet, Roberta, Albert were proposed. And what we show that the decisions of these discriminators, so this is for DVD, this is for ABD, they are correlated, like you have good correlation, so this is Cohen's case, but they are not perfect, like you don't have very high values for Cohen's case. The Cohen's case means if you have a ranking of the documents, is the ranking proposed by these methods the same? So if it's the same ranking, you should have 1. If it's very different, you should have 0. So having scores between .5 and .8 means that the ranking is kind of similar, but it's not perfect. So we can combine them because they kind of agree, but only moderately. And of course, by combining them, we get even better results. So if we only use BERT, we have seen what we get. If we use only XLNet, we get a little bit better because XLNet is very better. If we only use Robert, we get a little bit better. Albert is a perfect, it's the best one using most QA tasks right now. Is the best one, but if we combine all of them, even if the other ones are poorer, they have poorer results, we get an improvement both for the challenge and for the easy, about 2% improvement, but which is meaningful because it's difficult at some point to get, like if you look at the error reduction, the error reduction is kind of big. So here we have an error of 17, here we have an error of 15, so it's 2% 10% error reduction from 17.
It's more than 10%.
Relative.
Okay. And again, if we look at the distributors, and we can have these types, this is 36%. Again, AVD and DRTs, they are not good enough on their own, but if we combine them, we will get better results. Well, and so it's like approaching the end of the presentation, I hope it was like useful insights for you. So we can answer many questions correctly, even the challenge questions. So a human cannot survive the loss of the, which of the following, related to the first presentation, the appendix, the liver, a lung, and the kidney. The answer is B. Why is B? Because it's only one. Yeah, this is what the model should argue. Because you only have one liver. So for all the other ones, they are in pairs, and the appendix is only one, but we don't need it. And then there are some questions for which the model has an answer, and this other is labeled as incorrect, but it should be correct. Which of the following best describes the mass of a solid block of ice? And the correct answer is A, the amount of matter in the block, which is clearly correct, the amount of matter is the mass. And B was the amount of space of the block takes up, which is the volume. So our model considers that the volume is important to describe the mass. And actually, there is, if you know the density, you kind of have a relation. So this is what our model learns. And for other ones, the answer is completely wrong. Here, like which characteristic of a cheetah is more likely to be learned rather than inherited? And the correct answer is speed. Like if you have a cheetah that has a very good speed, its offspring will have also a very good speed. This is what happens like with horses. And until these guys in genetics came up when modifying the genome, what people did, they looked which was the fastest horse or the strongest horse, and they made that the horse have more offspring because that was the best way of proceeding. Now you can like modify the genome. And so you can inherit speed, but you cannot inherit hunting strategies. Hunting strategy is something you love. You could inherit hunting strategy, it could be great because you could inherit natural language processing skills, and our children maybe would be good at machine learning, NLP, and genomics. Well, so here it's completely wrong. And like QA going further, where are we? We're about here for our reasoning challenge. So this is a paper from Microsoft, very good paper from Microsoft, clearly one of the top papers in NLP in the last 6 months. So it's a, from my point of view, the most important paper after BERT. They use adversarial training for improving the performance of several NLP tasks, and this is huge. And all the other ones are like Roberta and so on, and also our model is like on the sixth place. I'm sure that we can do better. I'm not sure like if we can beat 3LB, but we will put several weak discriminators and we'll see what happens. There is also a lot of buzzword, like LNAI said that they surpass the barrier of answering questions, science questions, and they had about 3 or 4 months ago a lot of press on this stuff, like I think that you need to have 65%, and you have seen like right now these models that are 67. So we have managed to build a computer program which is able to answer science grade, like 8th grade questions in order to pass the exam, not to be the best, like not achieve human performance, but at least pass the exam. So this is like the buzzword. I'm not really sure if this happens, because what happens? They pre-train these models on several science data sets, including question answering data sets. And my question is, and my intuition, and I'd like to go a little bit more into this, is that there are some questions that appear, or very similar questions that appear in both data sets. Nobody has looked into it. Like, we have this data set on science questions, we have this other data set on science questions, and wow, if I train on one of them, I have very good performance on the other one. My intuition is that some of the questions are very similar, and this is why it was so great. So what can we do to go further? So what people do now is they fine-tune transformers or larger text in order to the screen. Like fine-tune the transformer, and like have a transformer that understands better science texts, not science questions and answers, only science texts. It's like a perfect
this is difficult, it takes time, it takes human answers.
Humans are able to answer questions without looking at, I don't know, tens of thousands of questions and answers. You just read a book and you are able to answer some of these questions. We don't need to read 1 million pairs of questions and answers in order to get, like, this is not a way of having reading comprehension. It's not reading comprehension at all. It is not really question answering the way to do it. Adversarial training, I agree, like modifying the question and answer a bit and still being able to answer the question correctly. And maybe some other ideas. I'm sure they will come. And why? I think it's not a good way of just adding questions and answers. Like IBM released the Tech QA dataset about 6 months ago, and they pre-trained as much as possible. They only get about 50% accuracy. It's a dataset with technical question answering about IBM products. They would like to have a question answering method that works good. They only have a couple of hundreds, close to 1,000 labeled questions and answers. These are, this is the data. You cannot make more data. You cannot build 1 million questions and answers related to IBM products. How can you solve this problem? Like, this is why adding more questions and answer pairs is not always the way to go. In conclusion, question answering is a hot topic, but it comes in so different flavors. Deep learning models have improved a lot the power of question answering, RNNs, and then of course transformers, for all data sets and for all tasks. Achieving human level performance, we are not there yet. We might be there yet for squad or some news, the data set, if you want to get into the spotlight, in the news. But for more complex data sets like ARP, HopQA, and so on, which require some reasoning, top solutions are still far away from human performance. And for small data sets, we are very far away from good performance. And OpenQA in particular is very difficult, because OpenQA means the answer is there somewhere in written text by humanity, but we don't know where it is. Yeah? And this is where we should look at, not just this is an article, the answer is somewhere in the article, find it. Well, if you want to look at more into the type of question answering data sets and tasks, you have there a list of all the problems which are interesting for the community. I thank you all for staying here so late, and if you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer. From my point of view, ontologies may be useful for some factoid question answering, but otherwise, I don't think it's an effort worth investigating. Like, this is the previous, for algorithm, for the AI reasoning challenge, the previous methods, like, build some graphs, open ID meant like building tuples from text and so on. And these methods didn't have, like, it was like 26%, 27% accuracy. So it was, you can invest lots of time in building these methods and you wouldn't be able to know how to use them. So you have there the knowledge base, but nobody knows how to use them efficiently.
The ontologies and the meaning ontologies based on annotations. Yes, and not random tuples.
Even using annotations, from my point of view, I don't think that ontologies can help a lot. Maybe for some particular questions, but otherwise,
if you give a text from medicine, what chances that even Albert can?
My intuition is that if you have a large enough collection of texts and the computing power you need, this method will be able to kind of build the ontology. This is one of the things they learn. Like, they learn relations, they learn stuff that you usually put in ontology. Like, if you have one perfect answers, ontologies are the way to do it, but you will have, like, great precision, not a very good report, because you will not be able answer many questions. But for the ones you have an answer, the answer will be perfect because you have it in the ontology. So if you want explainability, you want to have good precision, ontologies are great. If you want to have recall and to answer as many questions, I will go like for deep learning.
Recently there was this news that Google released reformer, transformer, like I'm curious about if you have an opinion on it and can it be potentially used like same way like BERT or reformer.
Yeah, I see, for sure. It can be put in the discriminator. I've seen the paper, I think it's a mass out or something like this. So it's a better transformer model. I haven't read the paper, I don't know what. But it's an improvement.
Has anybody looked at the questions for where the system fails? Are they qualitatively different from the others?
Unfortunately, no. Nobody has looked at the questions for where the system doesn't provide the correct answer. And from my point of view, this is something really worth investigating. Especially for LLAI, because they had like that type of reasoning labeled for each question, they didn't release it, but they could look at which type of reasoning the system is failing in order to understand what kind of reasoning the BERT or the transformers aren't able to capture. And there hasn't been any paper related to this. So only quantitative results having better models and no qualitative and understanding what's beneath under the hood of these models. And I think this is really bad, and we are trying to investigate this aspect. Together with like the qualitative aspect of looking if the transfer from other data sets is real or really repeat some of the questions or they are very similar. Because this is also another qualitative aspect, really important. If the questions from the other data sets, if they are very different, it's okay, but if they are very similar, this is not okay.
How do you think to apply reinforcement learning? You said there that you can use reinforcement learning.
I think reinforcement learning can be used in a similar way to adversarial training. So for adversarial training, is a kind of which are the words you should add or remove from the question in order to be able still to respond to it. Like it's similar to informers of terms, if you want. In a similar way, I think that one of the main reasons all these methods fail is because when you put a question and the answer, you don't have enough information. You should bring some new words which are related both to the question and to the answer, and maybe they are not related to the other methods. So if you like, you have a reinforcement learning method which try to place a new one new word and see if by adding this word you have a better answer. So this will be, so the action will be putting a new word to the question and answer. New word which is related to the question is also related. This is how I will see it. I haven't seen for the ARC any paper.
And this one comes from the in paragraph that you want to have, or is that extra?
No, this word shouldn't look as a paragraph. This word should come up before without looking at Wikipedia or anything. You should, like, what I think, like, we have a question, we have an answer, and some words activate, and you should also. This is how probably a human brain works. Some words which are pretty similar to the question and the answer activate, and you kind of go on this inference path. So we should have one word or two words extra, which are really related, pretty similar, really important to answering that question with that answer, without looking at it. It's very simple.
How about creating some auxiliary questions? Because as humans, usually it's the question, and you divide it in parts, and you answer them, and then you can make a graph of auxiliary questions and get the answer. Well, not questions, but representation of questions.
It makes sense, yeah, it should work, but I don't know, nobody has been able to find such a method to do this. But I like the idea.
Thank you. Thank you a lot, Ryan, for this very nice presentation. Thank you.
you all for being here. We hope to see you on our next event. And keep your eyes on your emails, because you're going to get a feedback email about what you think about the event. And we'll see you next time. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot.